Today we're going to be interviewing one of the savviest local real estate investors here in Long Beach and someone that I refer to as the king of value add. Hi everyone, Juan Huizar here, president of Sage Real Estate, your fourplex market leader and your highest rated apartment broker in the city of Long Beach. Today we're going to launch our newest series and it's called Learning from the Best Investors in Long Beach. What we're going to be doing is tapping the shoulders of the investors that are doing it right here in Long Beach. And why are we doing this? We want to learn their mindset, tips, tricks, any advice that they could give us, either whether we're getting started, whether we have ownership issues, or whether we're thinking of selling and have this exit plan. We're going to be getting all the information. We're going to ask the questions. We're going to learn from local pros so that you could become a better investor. Today, we're going to be interviewing Mark Malan. Mark Malan is a local real estate investor, college professor, got his MBA out of Cal State Fullerton. He's a CCIM, Certified Commercial Investment Member. Only 6% of commercial brokers have such a designation. He's also an MAI, a member of the Appraisal Institute. So he's a commercial appraiser. For the biggest of the biggest assignments, when there's pending lawsuits, they need an MAI. Mark comes with us with tons of experience. He's a contractor. He has purchased everything from small condos to hotels to self-storages to land. He's done condo conversions. Mark has done it all. He's seen it all. He self-manages. He's purchased. He's assembled groups, syndicated deals. We have a lot to learn from him, and we're super excited that he's today's first guest. We talked about ownership, acquisition, value add, financing. We talked about property management, everything and anything having to do with buying, owning, and selling real estate. We've covered it all. You're gonna learn a lot. So without further ado, let's do the interview. Mark, for those who don't know you, why don't you share a little bit about your background?
Sure. My name is Mark Malan. I was born in Long Beach. I live in Long Beach. I have a lot of investments in Long Beach. Now I've done investments in other places, but I find that the greatest value add, the greatest opportunity for more profits are right here where we have the greatest density of people. So I'm just a local guy. Buying real estate.
Would you tell us just a little bit about your background? Broker, contractor, appraiser, professor, everything else.
Okay, great. To be fair, I do have an MBA in real estate finance out of Cal State Fullerton. I've been a licensed contractor for about 30 years. I've been a designated an MAI, a real estate appraiser, for about 25 years. So I've been involved with real estate a lot of different ways. Continuously making investments on my own.
We have lots of questions because we want to learn from you. We want to learn from the best who are doing it here in our backyard. Right. So here are a few of the questions that I'd like to ask. Please. Okay. So the first one is, Mark, tell us what first inspired you to buy your first investment property?
Oh, very good. We had sold the big house in Cypress when our daughter went off to the university. And what we decided was to buy something in Long Beach that was a smaller house and had some units next door to it. And so we started that particular way.
And what was the goal with having units? I mean, what was the, because a lot of folks don't want to have a house and have tenants next door. Like what were you thinking when you first did that?
Well, let me tell you two things. The very first off, the tenants next door is the best. The reason it's the best is because I don't have anyone next door who rides a Harley, who tunes up jet skis in their garage till 10 p.m. I actually control my neighborhood by renting to the people who I figure are most similar to me, not in age or size or religion or race, but in the type of personality that they have. So like I said, I don't have that kind of neighbor that I wish I could get rid of. In fact, if I ever did, just give a 30-day notice, right?
Right. So when you first got started, was it creating passive income? Was it building net worth, or was that not even part of the equation? What was the real motivation?
That's a good question, because like a lot of investors, I didn't have a regular day job selling some real estate, doing some construction, doing appraisals. There's no 401k, essentially. There's no retirement package. And so we thought if we sold the big house in Cypress and moved to Long Beach, that the units would supplement whatever Social Security was available at the time that we did get to retirement age, and we would have that additional income. And that also taught us to have the units close to our house and how to pick good tenants. And so with that said, it just made sense that we bought more and more properties near where we live.
Which brings me to my next question. So a lot of our clients are first-time investors. Some of them own a lot of units. Some of them have started with their first triplex, fourplex, et cetera. When should they consider buying more? Like, when did you decide after that triplex, I'm gonna buy something else? And then how did it just go into all the things that you ended up buying through the years?
I was a late bloomer. It took me a while to get that. Of course, you had to build the equity in the bigger house before I bought the small house with the units. Right. But the idea was is that as I realized how easy it was, not simple, but easy, the rent checks come in on the first of every month. And the beauty is that although your mortgage might be tapped for 30 years, so let's say your payment is $3,000 a month, well, your rent might start off at $2,500 a month, but within a couple years, it's at $3,000. A couple years after that, it's at $4,000. But your mortgage is staying right there, simple at the $3,000 level. So it made sense that I had more and more retained earnings, and to buy more units gave me more retained earnings. And so that was the idea, was to just keep growing the net worth and, of course, the monthly income.
Mark, tell us, there was a story that you shared with me in the past that when you were an appraiser, you experienced something. That you experienced that as an appraiser, you were getting paid per the report. But tell us, but what was that experience that you saw what the investors were doing?
Thank you to my wife, okay? The reason that I'm rich is because I've got a great wife, okay? I come home frustrated. I get paid fine. I get paid, like, back 25 years ago, $5,000 for an appraisal of a corner. And I come out with what they ought to do with the strip center and a 7-Eleven and you know, the nail salon, the typical strip center. No, they put in like a car wash. It's gonna make half as much money for them. It's not that it uses up all the land, but it didn't make money. I come home frustrated. And my wife said, well, if you know so much, why don't you do it yourself? So I gave it a shot and we've been buying ever since.
One of the things that Mark had shared with me early on was I realized that the guys making the money was the real estate investor. And I guess when you're an appraiser, maybe that was kind of your, maybe that was your inspiration. You saw these guys building wealth and you're like, you know, I should give that a try. And Certainly you were the one that was advising them. So that made perfect sense. A lot of our clients are calling us and there's two questions. And so the first one is Juan, do I buy here in Southern California where in their perception, it's a really low rate of return, or do they go out of state where they could buy more doors like that? You know, tell us what your thoughts are about
that. And my thoughts come from my friends, because when you have friends, when you do apartments, you have friends that have apartments. So I've got the friends that went out to Arizona and bought a gigantic complex at a low price. No one told them that we didn't think to ask. No one thought to ask. The air conditioner for the entire complex on massive chillers that are the size of railroad cars up on the roof. Well, when those go down, you're hundreds of thousands of dollars in the hole. It's not a window air conditioner, it's a chiller. I've got another friend that went to Texas, bought 50 units, never figured out, although they were sub-metered, and he did a very good job because he was an appraiser. He went through stuff. He looked at his list. He checked things out. No one told him that the landlord pays for all the electric meters. Yeah, they were sub-metered, but it was an expense of the landlord. So I see these experiences about going out of town. I'm a more simple kind of investor. I want things a little easier in my life. So I buy where I can, what I call, kick the tires. I may not know who my tenant is if it's been rented by my property manager, my teammate, but I can drive by. I can tell you whether the porch light works at night, which is on without a switch because of security reasons, so that we have good insurance. But I can also tell you about what's going on out there. Did someone graffiti something? I want to know that my properties are at the top end of what they can be so that I can get the maximum profits and minimize my expenses. Buy local, kick the tires.
There you go. So one reason to stay in Southern California is to be able to visit your property. We've had friends who have gone out of state, and sometimes their property manager out of state tells them that there's vacancies when all along there was no vacancy. They were just skimming the rents off the top. True, so there's things to consider, but talk to us about cash flow and appreciation.
Okay.
Give us your thoughts there.
Well, first off, if you want a bigger cash flow, if you want a bigger rate of return, you can go inner city, you can go to Barstow, you can find these don't wanters, people who have investments that don't want them and they want out, and you can get the better cap rate and still be in state. So the idea is that it's close. I know I'll never have a problem with my vacancies because when I get a 30-day notice, I put out the sign, and before that person's moved out, it's already re-rented. You don't get that in other markets. Then I always get to jack up the rates, which is a neat thing. Your rent increase is really positive, not only for your cash flow, but when the other tenants see that the new one goes for $1,895 and they're still back at $1,695, they realize, oh, I've got a great deal, I'm not gonna leave. Right. And so they understand the market value just by seeing the for rent sign in front of their property, and that keeps them right in their own place and they get a great deal out of it.
Where do you see Long Beach as an option for other investors that are just getting started? Oftentimes, investors from other cities who are looking in El Segundo, Inglewood, and they're comparing us to them, and they're calling me and saying, why should we choose Long Beach? What advice do you have for those investors?
Long Beach is a phenomenal city. I'm not just saying that because I was born here and I live here, okay? Long Beach is great. They're organized, it's a regular city. You're talking fourth or fifth largest in the state, so it has all the benefits of being a full-blown city. At the same time, it's large enough that we have areas of single family homes where there aren't apartment complexes, and we've got every kind of retail. We've got the Port Authority and the largest shipping container equivalents is what it is. Our harbor has more freight going through it in containers than any other harbor in the United States. So we've got the port, we've got the city, we've got all the benefits and the infrastructures. It's old, so it's not brand new, which means we have space. If you get to a new city like Lake Forest and the people park on their driveways and the bumpers on the sidewalk because there's just no driveway. Here we got driveways that fit four and five cars. So it's just a different thing. Lots and lots of old properties. So there's opportunity to find those investments that need love. And that's where we can make extra money, is we find the one that the other person didn't love. And then we make it be this beautiful alternative to the future.
Can someone begin investing in real estate with no money?
I see those things on the internet and Channel 13 late night programs. Invest in real estate, come to our seminar. Yeah, the seminar's free. They're gonna sell you a $350 or $500 course and books. And who's gonna loan to you with no money? Who's gonna loan? If no, the answer is no. Now, do you need to have money? Let's look at it. You're gonna buy a house to invest. Maybe your first investment is a house, and then you can put the ADU in the backyard. So to buy the house, maybe you need $50,000 down. So why don't three buddies get together and put up $15,000 a piece? Boom, you got it. You don't need to have the $50,000. You need to originate it somehow. Yeah. Okay, why not tie in with your buddies that you already do, bowling or drinking or whatever, you got friends. So pull together on your first one. Then the next time there's only two of you, and the next time after that, there's just one of you. So you don't have to bring everybody with you the entire path. But if you don't have enough money to go out and buy one, then put together a couple guys and go do it together.
Do I need a real estate agent or a broker to assist me?
You don't need one by law. When you're buying, it costs you nothing to have a real estate broker or agent with you because those fees are paid by the seller. So I would say definitely use one, get the professional to take you through the course. You do too. When we do a deal, we hire an outside person, a transaction coordinator, just to make sure. Every year there's more and more pages of these contracts. So that we don't get our licenses in trouble, you actually have someone who's called a TC, or a transaction coordinator. So even though we're licensed and we know how to do these things and we go to the seminar, it's too easy to have a mistake. So have a licensed professional take you through the process.
How do you determine the rent to charge on a property, Mark?
Well, how much do you have? I'm always doing a rent survey. When you're in the business, you're in the business. So when a for rent sign pops up a couple blocks away from a property that I have, I'll read the sign. I'll stop and pull over. Sometimes I just take a quick picture of it so that later I can call the person and figure out what it was. Was it a two bedroom? Was it bathroom? Two bedroom one or two bedroom two? You know, what exactly configuration? Did parking include it or not? So I like to know what's going on in the market. I always enjoy when I go to re-tenant a slot at a higher rate than what the existing tenants in my building already are paying, so they know they're getting a good deal.
Got it. So a rent survey is something that anyone could do, right? I mean,
absolutely.
you don't need a license. All you're doing is walking around, driving around, looking for rent signs, going online, and just simple comparison is what
exactly.
You're doing?
Exactly, that's all we're doing is comparison. And it, certainly if you go online, you can find more for rents than you ever wanted to have. And then you start to get the flavor of what's going on in that neighborhood.
Got it, thank you. Mark, which mentors played a role in your success?
I've had a couple good ones, but the king of my mentors is a fella who's retired off to Florida. His name is Jeff Chauncey. A great guy, was always there, always supportive of me, always telling me I was going forward and doing the right thing the right way. So it's nice to get the positive reinforcement, even because he was more significantly more wealthy than I was, he was able to make me loans. Now, sometimes I was able to get him to invest with me, but most times he just loaned me the money. I have a lady right now, a couple blocks over, that gives me money anytime I want it, because I've made her so much money over the last 25 years, I just have that rapport with her.
And just to be clear, she's not giving you money, she's lending you money, right? I mean, you're paying interest on this, right?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I pay market rate interest, but I don't do an appraisal, I don't do a credit report. I just call up and ask and say, hey, I'm going to buy something and I'm putting half down. Would you come up with the other half? And she goes, yeah, great. Give me a first trust deed. I'm with you. Because she knows she's always paid on time. So take care of your reputation. Pay the people you owe, whether they're vendors or concrete suppliers or the people you borrowed from.
Can you describe a day in the shoes of a real estate investor or an apartment owner? What's it like?
There's always something. You never know what that day is going to be. You know, these other jobs, you go to your desk, you work certain hours, you know when your break is, you know when your lunch is. This is different. You'll get a phone call, you'll pick up a message, and you'll have to, someone might want to say, oh, my water's not working, or hey, this is that. You got to check it out or assign it out. I always have a little project going somewhere, so I like to, on my way to or from lunch, to drive by that project and see, did the concrete get delivered, or are they all through? Is it smooth? Is there a problem? Do I have to figure it out? So I'm a little hands-on. I don't want to be the guy pouring the concrete. I don't want to be the guy running the wires, but I would like to go see and say, this is where the meter's going to go, and come back when it's all done.
I know you've managed your own buildings this entire time.
Yes.
That was kind of your part of your full-time job. It gave you something to do, right? But do you recommend that someone get started and be their own manager, or do they hire that out?
I think that the best way to get the experience is just to do it yourself. Yeah, even if it's a single family home and someone will do it for $50 a month, do it being the manager. It's more important that you get the experience. Now, you're gonna go months that you won't even get a phone call from that particular property, and the checks just come in on time. But then you know whether or not they're coming in because they're coming into your house, to your office, to your P.O. box, wherever it is. So you are involved with the management at that level. Yes, if you have a whole bunch of stuff, you need a staff or you need a management company. But I'm back to being a small-time investor, thinking that I want to kick the tires, I want to know the properties, and I want to know where they are and what condition they're in.
Mark, what characteristics or skill sets is needed to becoming a successful real estate investor?
Patience. It's not get rich quick. You're not going to buy it today and become a millionaire tomorrow. That's not going to happen.
Okay.
I don't care how many courses you go to, how many books you buy. It's just not going to happen.
Okay.
But if you're buying in California, if you're buying in Southern California, you know it doubles. Now, you can say every 10 years or 8 years or 12 years, but somewhere out there, that thing is doubling. So just buy and hold. Take care of your tenants.
Pretty simple strategy. I mean, it's not rocket science.
Oh,
no. Okay.
Long Beach, tens of thousands of units. I mean, everybody's doing it. Yeah. There's no reason for everybody not to have a couple fourplexes. In fact, my theory is that if you have three fourplexes paid in full, you will have more money for the rest of your life than you could ever spend. So what's it take? 20 years? 25 years? You're going to live 20 or 25 years anyway. Why not just be really rich? I never understood that. When I was teaching at the college, and these guys are every week they come with the name of a new seminar sponsor, something they saw on TV or on the internet. It's like, no, nothing is going to happen for you. It's not easy. It's just something that you do. It's not hard, but it's just a process.
You taught at the college.
Right.
You know, people come to you for advice all the time.
Right.
People want to get started. They see what you've done.
Right.
You make it look easy. What holds people back from taking that first step on their first investment?
You know, it's not just about real estate, it's about investing. And I don't know exactly, but this is what I've seen. And this is my buddy who invented a left-handed wrench for one-armed mechanics. Perfect. And he had like three of these different kinds of tools that he created because he was a craftsman. He's really good. But he never took them to market. He never did anything with it. Anyone can sit around and have a beer and come up with a new idea for a business. But that isn't doing it. So why aren't people doing it? I think the first thing is they lack support. Now, they lack support a lot of times from their family and their friends, which is counterintuitive. And so why is that? And I come to the idea that perhaps when you come up with the new concept, a bowling ball that someone can use that didn't have fingers, when you come up with a real estate deal that is, you can't miss. Your friends are worried. Some of them love you so much that they're afraid that you're going to lose your money and you're going to be destitute and you're going to be all depressed. And there's a good number of your friends that are afraid that now you're gonna go be a millionaire and you're not gonna be a friend anymore. You can't have beers anymore because now you're hanging with the fancy guys, okay? And you move to the fancy neighborhood because now you got good money, you got big money. And so you move away. So you're not gonna come to Long Beach to have a beer if you're living out in Palo Verde's estates, okay? So I'm worried a lot of times that people don't take that jump because they're not getting the right amount of support at home and from their friends. So if you find that the solution to this, if you find that you're not getting that level of support and people are naysaying you, don't tell them. Now, still let them be your friends. Still love those guys because they like you. Okay, you got a relationship with them. But don't tell them about your next investment until you've made it. If they're not one of the people you're asking for cash to be your partner, don't tell them about it because then they're gonna worry that you're gonna get all rich and then you won't like them anymore. So they want the status quo and they like you and they don't want to lose you. And so I think that's the serious reason why people don't move forward is they just are not getting that buddy to say, hey, yeah, let's go do it.
Right, right. When you're touring a property that you might buy, like what things are you looking for? Whether it's an apartment building, a commercial building, a house?
I'm a little different. And okay. So don't try this at home. I put in offers to buy properties without ever seeing them. I know approximately how much per square foot I want to pay in a range. I assume the stuff I'm buying is not pretty, so that's okay. I assume I'm gonna be putting in new kitchens and bathrooms. I just assume that because that's the kind of property that I buy. Then once I'm accepted into escrow and I know that I've got a locked up deal, then I will go look at the property almost all the time.
Okay. Okay. Now, but this is coming from an investor who's been doing this for 40 years. Yes. So they're not looking at the property. Is,
it's not a technique that people use.
Right, or if you're looking to get started, and it's certainly something you don't wanna do right off the bat.
No, not at all. But get started.
And we kind of touched on this. What are some of the pros and cons of hiring a management company, property management company?
Property management company, you've got someone to handle all your problems. They will handle the bulk of your problems and they will collect your rents and even sometimes pay your mortgages. Now, I did at one time use a management company because I had a partner and the lady collected rents for 2 months, didn't pay the mortgage and then left town. So I have had personal experience of that not being good. Prior to that and after that, I've always managed my own. Most management companies, you can find them, they're legal, they're licensed, they're bonded. If they've got a California a license, which they have to have, there would be a restitution if they did wrong. I would just say that the management company is a way to remove yourself from the ownership of that investment.
And I would say this, if someone has a full-time job, you know, runs, you know, is a manager of a business that takes a lot of their time, then that person should probably have a manager.
Absolutely.
But like I have friends that have extra time because they're firemen. Yeah. And so, you know, they work 3 days on right. And get so many days off. In that situation, that's a perfect type of opportunity where you could manage.
When you buy local, then you can see your property. If you're buying 10 minutes, 20 minutes from your house, you can be there at any time to check out things. A tenant will say, oh, the water's coming off the roof. Well, you gotta go see what it is. You can hire a plumber for $85 an hour, you're gonna go look and go, oh yeah, that's the rain gutter, I guess it broke. Okay, so go figure it out yourself. It's really easy, it's not hard to manage these properties. I'm not saying that everybody who buys a property should be a handyman, you don't fix your tubs, you're not putting in new kitchen faucets. It's great if you can, but you don't need to. That all those things are services that you can buy, but if you have a local property, you can touch it, you can know it, you can see what the problem is.
We worked together for 18, 20 years. Yes, you know, you were my mentor. We became business partners, and we've had a lot of success together. Yeah, and so a lot of what I, a lot of my coaching came from learning from you and learning from the best. And so one thing that you've done, because of the appraisal background, your construction background, you're literally the king of value add. I've seen you reposition convalescent homes into self-storages. Right. I've seen you take old industrial rundown buildings and made them into like little strip centers.
Right.
You know, obviously that's your investment of choice is right. Value add. Talk to us about value add, the importance of it, because a lot of investors out there, that's what they talk about. Yeah.
I owe that education and that experience to the Appraisal Institute, where I was later designated as MAI, learning the highest and best use. It's always the highest and best use analysis. It's more risky than a standard apartment or buying a house. When you buy a beat up industrial building and turn it to a retail center. I mean, there is more risk and perhaps more cost, but the upside is significantly more. But right now, especially in Long Beach, okay, but all of California, is the ADU, the accessory dwelling unit opportunities. And I know you've done some videos on them. And I will just tell you that anybody who has a house should be focused on thinking about the ADU. Don't worry about having a tenant in your backyard. Every month you get a couple $1,000 check from them. You'll turn out to like them. They might even be your friends. Okay, they'll take the newspaper off the porch when you're not there. So the idea is, find that application that works for you with your risk level. The one thing I'll say about the ADU, which is the most amazing thing, and I've built them and I've sold them, and I will tell you that when I put an ADU for $150,000 or $200,000, the value of the property goes up double that. So I've got closed escrows to show me that when I put in an ADU in the backyard, that not only do I remodel the house and have its value go up, but I also have a doubling of the value of what the ADU cost me. If I had my druthers, I would just buy all the houses in Long Beach and do it to all of them.
So one example that we have, in fact, it was an investment that we did successfully, right, was, and this is where we realized that if we put in $150,000 on the ADU cost, right, that's our total cost, the value of that actual ADU is $300,000.
Exactly.
So that's a perfect example of value add. You're adding value, not to mention we're creating housing, right? Which is really
a critical thing.
Which is the most important portion is that we're creating housing. We know there's not enough housing. That's why the vacancy is so low. There's just not enough housing out there. So state wants more housing. This is kind of a way to work with the city, with the state,
yes,
create more housing, and at the same time, set yourself up for cash flow, for appreciation.
And your net worth, your net worth goes up. And the bottom line is, in the end, it's your net worth is gonna be that return that gives you your monthly income. You don't always have to be buying one more. You don't always have to be working hard. And some people actually turn their properties over to management companies so that all they have to do is cash one check a month.
We deal with a lot of investors who have owned apartments for a while, right? And they'll contact me and say, hey Juan, like, am I maximizing my investment? What should I do next, right? Do I sit tight? Do I refinance? Do I go out of state? What advice do you have for someone that, call them a longtime apartment owner?
I would say the most important thing to do is the gentrification. You already own the building, you already have the mortgage. Sometimes you own them long enough that the mortgage is nothing or paid off, but you have the asset, so gentrify it. And I'm telling you that the tenants will pay extra if they move into a place where there's a brand new stove. When I install the new stoves and new dishwashers in my apartments, I leave the owner's manual and in the dishwashers, the sample soaps that come from the manufacturer, I leave them in there. So when the tenant comes and looks at the apartment and they open up, it might be a 100-year-old apartment, but they open up the stove and there's the warranty, and they open up the dishwasher and there's the soap from the manufacturer. Put in the new appliances. Drop in another $3,000 or $5,000 with the appliances. Make it be nice. Make it be the apartment that you want to move into. And if you do that, the income will go up and it's very solid. The people stay because they know when they leave you, they have to go to a place that doesn't have a digital timer on the stove. They have to go to a place that doesn't have an ice maker. Oh my God, it's prehistoric. So they stay with you because you gave them the best, and it doesn't cost that much to do it, and you make it back very quickly.
So Mark's advice is for those owners that have owned for a long time is make your units better. Invest back in your product and that return will come back, because what we found is that our tenant base here wants a better product. It doesn't always exist, but when someone does do a good job on a remodel and offers the amenities that they're looking for, they're gonna pay a higher rent,
that's
right?
True. That's
so,
true.
And then obviously that's how the value goes up in
right.
the property. You've been investing for 30, 40 years,
sure.
right?
Yes.
And you've owned hotels, self-storages,
yes. Yes.
Industrial buildings,
yes.
you've had land,
yes.
apartment buildings,
yes.
retail buildings.
Yes. I did a condo conversion.
You've done a condo conversion,
yeah.
you've owned cell towers.
Yeah.
I mean, so you've
yeah.
seen it all, okay?
Right.
You've seen ups, you've seen downs,
right.
you've seen bubbles.
Right.
What would you call the state of the market that we're in right now? Like, what are your thoughts about that?
Exciting. Opportunity is phenomenal. When you can borrow money for 3% or 5% on 30 years, just do it. Just do it. You're stealing money. If you want a great deal, then you lock up a mortgage, a 30-year mortgage. Don't go interest only. Don't go with some balloon payment in 3 years. Just get a 30-year fixed rate loan at a low interest rate, and you can't go wrong. Even if there's some vacancies, you can cover those, the small little payment negative, The bottom line is it will come back, and over time, we've got a history, even recession, no recession, whatever. It always increases. I look at it as a stair step, that we go up in the good times, we come down a little in the bad times. We go up in the good times, we come down a little in the bad times. And the up is always higher than it ever was, and we all know that. And the down never goes down as far as it did in the last time it went down. So don't sell in the down period, just sell in the up period. I've got property right now listed with Juan because this is a good time to sell. There are buyers out there and they can borrow money at 3%, 4%, 5%. Like I said, anyone who can borrow money that cheap, you got good credit, you got fair credit, go get it. Even if it's a house, go get it. Whatever it is, go get it, because it's going to be worth more tomorrow than it is today. That's just what we've learned through years of investing and holding properties.
Mark, thank you for that. What do you tell the folks that say, we're at the top of the market, why should I buy now if we're at the top of the market? What's your advice to them? I mean,
that's a good point.
Yeah, okay, right.
That's great. We're always at the top of the market. We're always at the top of the market. I buy something that's too much, but I really want that piece. So I pay just a little too much for it. A year later, someone tells me, you got the last best deal on that street. It's like, no, you can't understand the frustration I have as an investor. I taught at the college for 15 years. I taught real estate, finance, economics. I'm a contractor, I'm an appraiser. Okay, I'm in the market full on. My whole body and soul is into the market. And I hear people tell me how lucky I am. It's like, no, not lucky. I bought something and I held it. How can you hold something in 10 or 12 years and not have it double? It's not genius, it's just what happens. Now, this may not work in Topeka or Cincinnati, where people walk away from properties. Detroit, where they can't tear them down as quick as they go vacant. But we're talking Southern California. There's no more land here. Now to get land, you gotta go out to Hesperia or Barstow. So that's why the ADU thing is so great. It's using land that's already here. And most people who own a house aren't paying anything extra for the land, but they get to put a house on it. It's just genius. So that is the truth.
Okay, so let me just give another example. So you're the first investor that we're highlighting in this new series.
So
we're excited that you're here. Are you still buying in this market? So everyone says we're at the top of the market. You, as an experienced investor, are you buying right now, Mark?
I'm in escrow right now. I close next week. I found a really beat up duplex, but it's right over by the Long Beach Airport. And it has a gigantic 8,000 square foot yard. So I'm putting in a 20 by 40 ADU. So the duplex will be a triplex. It will spin handsomely every month. So they're there. The opportunities are out there. But yeah, I've never seen, to tell you the truth, I've never seen a termite report so bad in my whole life as the termite report on this one deal. And it's like, okay, whatever, they've agreed to fix it. I'll probably take a settlement instead, but they didn't want it anymore. They've lived their life, they're done with it, they're off to another thing, and this is my opportunity.
And this is a perfect example. So for some of you out there that want to get started, but you're getting advice from so-called online Instagram folks who are saying we're at the top of the market, here's a local investor who's buying something right now because he believes...
We're always at the top of the market.
Exactly. Okay, but you believe that there's still profit and still smart investments to be made.
Absolutely.
Of course.
And the top of the market for this beater that I'm buying right now will be significantly more than 3 years. Significantly more. I don't have to wait forever for it to be a positive cash flow.
Mark, so let's talk about this. You know, you've accomplished a lot. It's not been easy. I know it's a lot of work, right? You're not sitting back. You're actively managing your units.
Right.
Are you, you know, everyone's goal to get started is to someday, not have to work because there's enough income coming in from their properties. Are you now at that level? And how does that feel?
Well, that's a topic of my life now because, oh yes, there's way more coming in than what I would ever want to have or need. And we wonder why I can't stop. How come I have to go do one more deal? It's not net worth. It doesn't mean anything. The income isn't going to matter. I don't know. So I guess the creating the housing and the taking the beat up building and making it be the pride of the block. And I just love it. So you get addicted, I guess is what it is. It's just an addiction issue. And I want to do one more deal. I want to do one more deal. I don't want to do 10 at once. I don't want to go crazy.
You're a perfect example of this. You have no pension plan.
No.
Right.
Correct.
There's really no 401k behind you.
I've been self-employed my whole life.
Okay. Okay. But if you didn't want to work tomorrow, you don't have to work.
I'd make more money. The reason I'd make more money if I didn't work tomorrow is that I wouldn't be buying another dumpy property to take all my cash and stick it in. So it was just accumulate up. So I sometimes I get frustrated. I go, how come I'm not rich? Like, I don't know, money coming out of my pockets. And it's because every time I get another pile, I buy another building. So I don't know. I guess I've got issues.
You keep reinvesting
it. When you meet that counselor, have him call me.
Oh, you know what? I think when I get to your point, I think I might actually stop. But so two things. Most investors out there are investing for two reasons. One, they want to get to the point where they don't have to go to work and there's enough positive cash flow income coming in, right? So so you could check that off here.
You can't.
You could check that. And then also people want to create wealth, and I guess you could check that box also.
Yeah, absolutely. But even, I swear to you, you'll go by and see one of your properties that you've owned for 10 years that's making money, and you certainly don't need to buy another one, but there's a for sale sign on the one next door, and you go, oh yeah, I'll do that one too. I don't know what it is, but when you're involved with real estate, it's just fun that way. Now, I'm not saying the lady who calls you and says, I can't figure out how to work my shower, doesn't test you a little. But I have those calls going to somebody because I've got enough people now.
Mark, well, thanks for sharing that with us, because it's almost like I'm showing the end result of when someone does it right.
Right.
You know, and I'm not taking credit for this, although we did work together for a very long time.
We did.
But this is the end result of where you want to get.
Right.
And it seems like you have freedom, like you're independent, and most importantly, you're having fun.
I'm having fun. Yeah. I'm having fun. And the real estate is just the market. I don't know how to pick stock. When I pick stock, it goes down in value. Okay, I don't know how to do those kinds of things. I'm not gonna Bitcoin. I don't even understand what that is. So real estate, I understand. First of every month, checks come in. Some of it goes to the bank, the rest of it just sits around.
Got it. Mark, so obviously, you know, through the years of owning, it's not been easy, and I don't wanna create this series to show that you're gonna get started and you're gonna end up like Mark in year one, because clearly this is a long process. Talk about kind of the journey, some of the challenges. Owning real estate, it's not easy. I'm not making it seem like it is, but tell us some of your experiences.
The one that drives me crazy is banks. That's just banks. Banks like it, and I'll tell you, if you have a regular job, keep it. Banks wanna make a loan to you if you get a paycheck and you have regular pay stubs, and that. There's little boxes that they check somewhere in underwriting and you get a loan. If you're self-employed, it's really hard to get a loan. If you're self-employed and have a whole bunch of properties, someone could say, oh, well, you've got $10 million worth of loans. You go, yeah, but I got $50 million worth of properties. But they don't care about that. They go, oh, you've got $10 million of loans. How are you ever gonna pay for those? Mm-hmm. So banking is one thing that gets me.
Okay.
Tenants are sometimes a problem, but they're typically a problem when they have a problem, okay? So water flow is low, you might need to put in the copper piping. Let the lady get the shampoo out of her hair. I mean, come on, she's paying rent,
right?
So if you're taking care of your tenants, you don't really have the tenant problems, but the bank problems. Cities, all the time, somehow they decide to make a new law where everybody with a fourplex has to pay, I don't know, it's $135 a year or something like that. It's not a big thing, it doesn't.
Right.
But all of a sudden, you pay. It's with a hotel. I have a health inspector. Mm-hmm. The health inspection fee, this is in Catalina. Health inspection fee is like $600. So I'm paying $600 and nobody ever shows up. Okay. I'm not gonna call them and ask them to come out,
sure,
right?
Sure,
so there are always fees, there are always issues.
Okay,
so it's just managing the tenants, managing some of
the bank.
Yeah, and the bank issue is only an issue when you want to buy more, which is
that's right.
The problem you have, right?
So and I'm not big on refinancing to take all my money out to buy another one. I think that if you have a property that's 50 or 60% loan to value, you're in a big fat cash flow. Why mess with that? Why chance taking a problem?
Okay. I think some people would say, well, how do I move up? How do I scale up without that? So I think that's what someone might say.
And all of my buildings are typically smaller. I don't have any 50 unit buildings or 25 unit buildings. So I'm a more small individual investor, and coming from a really poor family, it's been a very slow trend up. So now I got a lot of years and the trend is very successful. But certainly it'd be more helpful if one of us would have come from a very rich family.
Sure.
Mark, tell us, what would you have done differently? You know, I guess now looking back and what you've purchased, like what asset type do you like better?
Yeah, you know, if I was teaching in 2006 and 10 and all that time, before. I did 15 years. But I was telling my students, the crash is coming, the crash is coming. But I continued to buy. Okay, I knew the crash was coming, but is it coming in 2 years or 4 years or 1 month or when is that crash coming exactly? There was no watch to look at. There was no paper to read. We just knew the crash had to come because people were buying million-dollar homes that had no jobs by putting 5% down. So the crash had to come, and because you can't time the market, I did make a couple mistakes on buying properties weeks or months before the crash. You can't know it. You can't time it. Just don't be heavy leverage, and you get to keep it all until the good times.
Okay, so there you go. Some tidbits, which is what I learned too in the last crash, is two things. Not taking advantage of short-term financing, financing that comes due too quickly, because that crash will swallow you during that wave. And so tell us, okay, speaking about a crash, okay. Online, there's a lot of folks trying to sell books and seminars that there's this crash coming. What are your thoughts about any current crash that could be coming, or is it not going to happen?
It has to happen. It is coming. It's called a business cycle. If you've been to one semester of business school, junior college class, you'll learn business cycle. It's something. Everything goes in cycles. So will there be a tough time? Yes. Will there be a time of high interest rates? Yes. Those will come. Those will go. The time of our growth is always more and better than the time of our demise.
And in terms of timing, I mean, what, this year, next year, 2 years, 5 years, any idea?
No idea.
Okay.
It will happen. It must happen. It's okay.
Okay.
It doesn't mean don't buy. It doesn't mean don't invest.
Right.
It just means maybe don't make a crazy investment.
What would be some tips that you would share with investors, either experienced or up and coming? What tidbits can we take away from this interview?
Invest where you want to own. Invest where you want to be, where you want to visit. You don't have to live on site. You don't have to buy the apartment buildings on your block like I do. But invest locally. Invest where you have comfort. You already decided to live there, so you must like the area. So why wouldn't someone else like it? Be good to your tenants. If you're good to your tenants, even if they have a problem, they're good to you. If you're mean to your tenants, or they don't even know who you are, and they're not comfortable with you, then they're the kind of people who you end up having to sue, or who sue you. Okay, if you're, my buddy bought a place, the lady got half rent, and what her job was to take out the trash can for the big company truck. He jacks her rent up to the lowest in the building, but twice what it was. Within 2 weeks, she had a slip and fall, okay? She made $60,000 by taking out the trash bin that day, okay? So be nice to your tenants. Be honest to the banks. Don't lie. Now it's a federal law. You lie on an application, you go federal penitentiary. It's not like it used to be 20 years ago, okay, where it was flim-flam or rounding errors. Now, so be honest. Just do a good job. If you do a good job, it'll all come back to you in aces, and you'll have more wealth and more income than you can use. Just do the logical thing and be the tenant while you're the owner. Be the tenant.
Awesome. Mark, we can't thank you enough for sharing your knowledge, your background with us so we can learn a little bit, and hopefully someday we'll be in your position, with the cash flow and the equity growth. And so, Mark, if someone wants to reach out to you, wants to maybe pick your brain, or wants to learn a little more about this ADU opportunity, what's the best way to get a hold of you?
Thank you for asking. Instahome2020.com is our website where we have our ADUs. Of course, you can always email me at Mark Malan, MarkMalan, at Outlook.com. I'd be more than happy to respond to anyone who has a question. Hey, I saw Juan's video, and I'll give him the straight scoop.
Awesome. Thank you so much. There you have it.
My pleasure. Thank you.
So there you have it, our first interview with Mark Malan. Outside of just having this tremendous energy and having so much experience and knowledge to share with us, he's also my mentor, my friend, my business partner. So today was a lot of fun for me so that I could share with all you folks out there a little bit of where my background comes from. Every situation is unique. Every investment's unique. If you have any specific questions or would like to refer someone to us, please let us know. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe below. See you next time.